Pastor Rick and Jennifer Pasquale of the International Christian Fellowship of Rome. And we want to say to you today, you're amazing. And the influence that comes into your life and out of your life is something we want you to put in God's hands. And you can follow us on our website and our social media for more information.
So we want you to listen to this conference that we provided here in Rome of these amazing speakers and their amazing stories.
Start here. How many of you are not married? Okay, so half the room is not married, so half the room is married. Okay, so this should be very interesting because some of you in this room that have been through this journey of wedding, marriage, can relate to what we're about to say. But remember, our job here is today to communicate to everybody in the room. So before the wedding, what's going to happen?
Well, I want you to realize that so many times we think of a marriage and a wedding and being coupled with another human being of the opposite sex, because that's what we believe that the Bible teaches, that it's only about those people who are married and in this relationship. But there are relationship skills that we read even in that scripture of Philippians 2, 1 through 7. So you can go back and look at that later, that the marriage before the wedding, the relationships that you have before the wedding are actually teaching you to practice relationship skills. You know, so many times we can be really kind and humble to people at work, and we forget to be kind and humble to people at home. And so as we talk about that, I want you to recognize, and we like to be honest, not too honest. Not too transparent. You got to preach tomorrow. So.
They need to know.
Okay. But there are three things I want to point out to you about before the wedding. And I didn't make you notes that have everything written down, because I believe when you're in a conference like this and you hear something that makes you, wait, I want to write that down, and you write it down, you remember it better than if I just handed you a bunch of notes. You might or might not read them. But if you write down something that God speaks to you, write it down. Hold on to it. That it may not just be for the marriage you're in or the marriage you will be in, okay? So the first thing is, recognize the past plays a part in everyone's story. Recognize the past plays a part in everyone's story. For example, when Pastor Rick and I met, my mother had been killed in a car accident. And just a few months, maybe a year at the most, before we met. And when we met, it was, I'm going to give away our age, but it was in a time when people would joke around, and when they would say something, then they'd be like, yo mama.
What?
You remember that?
No, I don't remember that.
Yeah. So when we met at a Christian conference, it's a good place to meet people at a Christian conference. Go slow if you're in this room. And we were joking around or something, and he said, yo mama. So later, when we had a chance to talk to him, I said, you can't use that one on me, because my mama's in heaven, and that bothers me. And do you know, I'm bragging on you from that moment forward, because my mom was killed in a car accident, if there was car trouble. Because we didn't have cell phones, if there were things that had a ripple effect, he just said, that's a boundary that she's given to me, and I'm going to honor and respect that. He could have said, oh man, this girl's lost, she's mixed up, her mom. He didn't. He took my past.
I thought you were going to talk about your drug addict boyfriend.
Well, that's another story. So we're going to stick on the marriage part, okay? I married you, thank the Lord.
It's before the wedding, before the wedding.
Okay, now the second one, you're going to go to number two, okay? So I'm going to hit over these. The second one, because I believe in being real honest, sexual integrity before the marriage and during the marriage is all about your choices. Where you go, what you watch, what you talk about, where you let your imagination run to. And you have to understand that when you're before the wedding, during the wedding, during the marriage, all throughout the time. It's not just the before. Those sexual integrity choices are very important. For the women, I can talk about other things at another time, but I just want you to know that your value is not in the ability to give sex to your husband or wife. I want to say that again.
We are.
Wow. I want you to understand that. Because if someone took that from you, you might think you're not valuable anymore. Or you might think that of your spouse. Oh, they're not that valuable. That is not true. Your value is based on the fact that God made you, He redeems you, and He wants you to make new choices when you decide to follow Him. And even in marriage, there are times when we have to make new choices, and we have to choose to stop letting our mind wander, so that is very important. How you operate with people outside of marriage before you get married is very important. So think about this, for example. If you met a boss or a coworker and you were thinking, I want that job. This person is my way into that job. You would not run up to that person and say, you're giving me a job. You're giving it to me right now. I think you need to listen to me. This is what you need to do.
No.
No. I've watched how you work with colleagues. You're very respectful. You're patient with them. If they tell you to do 3 steps and then you do those 3 steps and then they come back and say, oh, I want you to do 6 more steps for this job. You do it, don't you, if you want that job. It's the same thing in marriage, that you have to work through the process and be willing, once you get through part of the process and they say, it's a different season in my hormones or whatever, I need you to do this, you say, okay, let's talk through that. So making sure that you understand how you operate affects what's going to happen on the inside of that relationship in the coming weeks and months.
The only thing I want to add on point one is that she said it about her mother, but whether you agree with this or not, for those of you that are not married yet, you are marrying into a family. Okay, I'm going to say that again. You're getting the woman, if you're the man, you're getting the woman, but you're also getting the mother-in-law, the father-in-law, the brothers, the sisters, everybody. And for some of us, we think, oh, no, I'm just getting the woman. No. You're getting the whole family. So my advice is do your homework. Seriously. I told my girls as growing up, Jean Pool.
Not like jeans you wear, but like the jeans in your body.
Examine who they are. Examine the mother. Examine the father.
The relationships.
How they talk, how they live, how they look, et cetera, et cetera. Do they work? Are they faithful? You young people want help. I'm giving you.
So you're going to talk about how much my
advice.
Family loved on you before?
Exactly. They paid me a lot of money. No, just kidding. They put me through the ringer. Serious. I had to meet this Uncle Jimmy and this aunt and that cousin. And I'm thinking, dear Lord, these Southern people are weird.
But they fed you well.
Oh, my goodness.
Uh-huh. And then my aunt called me and said, he's really cute. He's kind of bossy. And then she said, does he know you're bossy?
No one ever knew that. All right, let's move on. So, again, there is before the wedding. So a lot of marriage conferences, you don't get before the wedding. You get what's happening after the wedding. But we thought like we should put that component into this teaching today. So number two is key elements for building any healthy relationship, okay? And our number one component, key elements for building any healthy relationship. So we want a healthy marriage. You want healthy friendships. You want healthy connections here. Our number one point is communication matters. I'm just telling you. I didn't think this woman talked. Seriously. She sit in my car on a date and no words.
Few.
Very few words. Where do you want to eat? No comment.
Wherever you'd like to.
Yeah. I mean, it was amazing to me. We'd sing, I'd like to sing on the radio, you know, hear the music play, and I'd sing out loud, and I'd look at her. Seriously. I told my family, I'm marrying the beautifulest, quietest girl on the planet. This will be amazing. You talk about amazing.
And then it got even more amazing, didn't it?
Because I found out she doesn't, and that's about communication. Mm-hmm. It would be a boring life if I had to do all the talking. It'd be a terrible life.
Amen.
But I found out she does talk, and she does her share of the talking. But talking is not only communication. Mm-hmm. You can talk, but you have to be able to say what you need to say in appropriate time and manner. Mm-hmm. There's always the right time to give your two cents. Mm-hmm. Be careful of when you give your two cents.
And I would say, too, that communication doesn't always have to be serious and intense. Sometimes it really is about saying, oh, this is going nowhere. Let's go get coffee. Let's go do something. Let's make a joke about this. So really important that we understand sometimes we only focus on the intensities. You've got to have some humor in your communication. So, for example, one time we had this communication thing, and I was learning that everything does not have to be resolved before we go to sleep. The sun not going down on our wrath actually means on me and on him. Like, I learned that God wasn't saying, keep him up until 4 o'clock to talk this out. Really, that God was actually saying, if you can't go to sleep with peace in your heart, that's a problem with you, not with him.
Amen.
And so, but I was very kind of frustrated about something. And so the Holy Spirit or creativity, whatever, I got a broom. And I made a little note, and the first place he goes is in the bathroom in the mornings, and I put the broom and a note that said, go ahead and sweep it under the rug. So in the morning, he saw that broom and that note, and he came and kissed me on the cheek, and we had a beautiful morning, and we both laughed. And I realized whatever I was upset about was, it was solvable. And he did care about what I was thinking. He was just really tired the night before. So you got to be able to have humor in your communication.
Communication, when you're talking with someone, is your body language. It's your expressions. You know, if she says something, you go. I mean, it's almost louder what your body just said and your facial expression was than what the words were. You understand? So you have to be very careful in the communication and figure out when is a good time to talk. Talking will help you. Pre-marriage, I'm just telling you, figure out how to talk and how your communication is going to help you resolve conflict. And if you think you're not going to have conflicts in your marriage, you're fooling yourself. Okay? Marriage is a constant from the day one. We got 40 years of marriage. It's a constant communication process, but a constant compromising process as well. Learning how to get along with each other. It can't always be my way.
That's
even though
on
I
camera.
Want it to
I
always.
Love it.
Huh? I said that publicly.
I said it's on camera.
I know.
That's awesome.
It can't always be my way. 99% of the time, yes. No, just kidding. 50% of the time, but more than likely it's 30%.
Not true.
It is true.
You can do the second one.
Okay. Respect is essential, and that communication leads to respecting each other. Her opinions matter. What she wants matters. How, if you want to really have a good relationship, you got to keep respecting each other. After the first year, after the second year, after the 10th year, there has to be a respect level for each other. Respect them and say it. Do things that demonstrate respect. Don't just assume because you've been married, they know. Mm-hmm. Now, some of your cultures are a little peculiar on this and not expression. Mm-hmm. Don't give the expression. Well, you've got to learn that remember what we teach in our church is you kind of got to leave your cultural things behind in some instances. And I'm telling you, in mutual respect, you have got to leave some of your cultural differences and accept what God has to say about this subject. Mm-hmm. Respect each other.
Amen. I think that's really important. And feeling valued and heard is very important. I'll tell you that on times when I had a different opinion of something we were supposed to do with the children or a decision that we were going to make, I can remember many different specific times, milestones, saying to him, this is what I feel, this is why I don't like this, this is why I'm worried about it, but I will say this to you. If I know that you have gone and prayed and sought the Lord, and I've even witnessed that there's a prayer time or a prayer closet, that matters to me. And you come back and you still feel this way, I will support that. And each time that I have recollection of that, I did learn that God was using him because he is a godly man and he is a godly husband to lead and guide our family. And either I would yield and say, yes, okay, I'm supporting you, this is good. And then if I felt uncertain, then we would put it to the Lord. And so one of those things, for example, was our daughter in eighth grade got beaten up at school and they went to public school. And that was one of those things I was thinking, I don't know if I want her to go to public school. And he said, it's going to be a great thing for them. And we did live in a very good public school area and city, and they were very advanced. But when she got beaten up, and it was very traumatic, she was very bruised and everything, I said, that's it. I want her out of that school. I want to put her in private school. This is not okay. And he said, well, we called for a pastor to come to our house. Let's ask the pastor to talk with us and her about what's going on and what she's feeling. And so he was hearing me. In the process, our daughter said, please don't take me out of this school. I'm supposed to be a light here. I'm okay. I will be okay. And so I said, if it happens again, then we will make a different decision. And we prayed, and she went back to that school. That person who beat her up was another girl, actually became her protector for the rest of her 5 years in that school district. But I felt heard and valued, and it was important. I mean, my daughter's life was at stake, not just her physical, but her emotional, how she would think about school. But she was included in that conversation, which I know you're going to talk about a little bit later. I kind of already touched on this before, but this goes for during as well. Sexual purity and integrity. And I want to just say, no porn allowed. If you're on the web, if you're doing stuff, the Bible says, you know, if you look at something, even as a lust in your eye, it's wrong. It's a sin. We don't want to live in sin. No sin can enter heaven. And you're not married to any of those people on that internet. You're married to that person that's beside you. So everything that you think about, that you interact with, should be with and about that partner that you love and value and respect, okay? So you just let the Holy Spirit guide you on that. Physical touch is precious. Use it, don't lose it. And again, I appreciate Pastor Rick acknowledging that we come from very different cultures, all of us. And we also he comes from a big Italian family, and they use their hands and they kiss on two cheeks, not just one. And I came from a very quiet, small, reserved family. And all his brothers and sisters are like jumping on me to give me a hug, and I'm, oh, what's happening? But I have learned to love that. Because I know that they are expressing such beautiful joy and love and affection. There is a healthy touch. And even in marriage, remember, we've already said the thing about respecting one another. There are times when you have to say, just give me a few minutes. But being able to touch, to say, I love you, you're valuable to me, I'm with you on this. Maybe a touch is the communication. Maybe I don't have the words. A lot of times he might not have the words for me. He knows that a hug or a touch can be just the thing I need just to calm down, feel it's okay. And some of those intimate touches are reserved for that person you're going to spend the rest of your life with.
Amen. The last one, let's just hit the honesty. Mm-hmm. Honesty is a must. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you right up. Be truthful. don't make up stories. Because I'm telling you, trying to get yourself out of that story is going to be harder than if you would have just spoke the truth up front. Mm-hmm. Speak truth. Be honest. And that is in every component of your relationship, as dating or as married. Be honest about your finances. Talk about it. I'm serious.
Even my little shopping money?
Gotta talk. You gotta have boundaries. You gotta have understanding of how money is gonna be spent in the house. Some people come from families that have structure and order and budgets and schedules. Other families come from women or men come from families. There is no boundaries. There is no control. There is no order.
And just like you said, everything has to be out in the open. So do finances. And while one person might do the finances or both might do the finances, what I think is most important is that there are no secrets in finances. You marry the family and you marry their past finances. And so very important that you know, like, what's going on in those financial areas and that, you know, I don't do all the details of the finances. That's not my thing. But if at any time I want to, I'm never afraid to say, show me our account. Show me what's going on. I mean, I have access and passwords and all that, but on specific things. So there are no secrets in any of these areas.
And if you'll learn a system, so not that we want to take any time in this component, but if you don't have a budget in your household, get one. Figure one out. And as a young person, figure out how to budget the financial aspects of your life. It'll make your life easier. Okay? Know where you're going, how you're going to get there. Whether it's $2 a week or $100, figure out how you're going to get there.
What would you say are the top three areas of the marriage that we just have to work on forever? Like, it's not that we did it in 40 years ago and now we never talk about it.
I would say there's no question. Probably the number one component of stress in a marriage has to do with finances. Coming either from the husband or the wife. I'm just telling you. And that's why if you can understand finance and get the structure, if you don't know that right now, get people around you that can help you know that. Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing that is like the common denominator in that is faith. So very important. I know that there are people in this room who have been married and are not married now. I know that there are people in this room that have been on a journey. I understand that. But I want to encourage you. Faith has helped us so many times.
Right.
When one of us felt like giving up on our job, our career, our kids, our marriage, our whatever, because both of us were rooted and grounded in the Word of God.
That was on camera.
And rooted, and I never wanted to give up on my kids for very long, maybe like 30 seconds. But I had to give them back to the Lord and say, God, I can't take care of this. You're going to have to take care of this. But it was, then that's when the other partner says, listen, you're trying to handle this by yourself. We got to give this to God. And we pray together every single night. And sometimes it's long, sometimes it's short, but we unite our hearts in faith before we go to sleep.
So
and
those of you that are pre-marriage
pivotal.
People, think about this. If you try to marry someone that is not in your faith, you are opening the door for major problems in your life. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you.
And you don't have
and
that
the Bible
support.
Says, teaches us how to marry one of the same faith. Because mm-hmm. if you try to marry outside of that, remember, you're marrying the family. Mm-hmm. You have just opened the door for multiple years of stress and struggle in a marriage. Mm-hmm. So God has the right person out there for you. I'm talking about the singles now. He has the right one out there for you. God will bring that person to you at the right time and the right place, mm-hmm. okay? That job is not up to you. That job's up to God. And some of you are saying, I wish he'd speed it up.
Yeah. And I want to say, finally, and we'll take a couple questions. I think we have some already that are on our notes. But healthy individuals make healthy couples.
Right.
Healthy individuals make healthy couples. And so what I mean by that, I feel like the Holy Spirit really gave me this and has taught me this in my 40 years of marriage as well, that, you know, there's a lot of rhetoric, I say, out in the world, things that people say. That, oh, isn't that sweet? This is Prince Charming, or this is my soulmate. The Holy Spirit spoke to me. Jesus, listen to me. Jesus is my soulmate. Because if he is my soulmate, and he leaves me or disappoints me or breaks something, that's going to break my soul. Jesus will never leave me or disappoint me or break my soul. Jesus is my soulmate. He is my life mate in this life. I believe that was a word from the Lord. And I will tell you that as a young girl whose mother was killed in a car accident, in the beginning, in the first couple years, and we didn't have cell phones. I know that's unbelievable, but, and he would be late coming from work. He worked at the church, and I would hear sirens, and I would think, oh my God, he's been in a car accident. I'm going to lose my husband the same way I lost my mom. Now, I know that doesn't make rational sense, but that was a fear the enemy was using in my life. Until one day God said to me, what if you do lose him? I'm still with you. You have not got, you can't hold on like that. Because then I would question him. Where were you? Why didn't you call me? What time were you? Blah, 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 blah. The minute he walked in the door.
God help me.
He was really glad when we got cell phone, because then he could say, hey, I'm going to be 30 minutes late, or I'm stuck in traffic, or I'm doing this. And you should be honest in your text messages. That's just a little side note. Not like my one child who says, I'll be there in 5 minutes, and she hadn't even left the house yet. But I want to say to you, let this person be your life mate, but let Jesus be your soulmate. And then you will be the healthy individual that you need to be. And then when you're not behaving properly, that goes for both of us, the soul, the person who cares for my soul, through his word, the word of God, says to me, this isn't his fault. You need to change your attitude right now. Right? So we listen to what Jesus has to say.
All right.
Okay.
Questions?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. That was wonderful. So give them a round of applause, please. So I think, I'm sure you have a lot of burning questions. And some of you actually, when you registered, you actually asked a question. So maybe we will start with one of those.
Okay.
And someone who registered said, what's the most difficult thing about being married?
I believe one of the most difficult things about being married is commitment in a world of runaway mentality. No matter who you are, the enemy is always going to try to break you up and break you down. And so you have to stay committed, because the world says, run away, forget about it, don't worry about it. That is not Jesus culture.
So let's see. Questions?
Nobody wants to ask.
Everybody's nervous.
Yeah.
Surely you have questions. Whether it's about communication, there was a lot of interaction, like communication, humor, body language. Sister Joyce.
Pastor, you tell us what the secret was in motivating her, Pastor Jennifer, to get on talking, or get him talking. One was on the quiet side, she was on the quiet side. You know, one partner talks a lot, the other one doesn't talk a lot. So how do you get the one that doesn't talk a lot to get to flow, you know?
So what
I think there must be some
the
skillfulness.
Secret?
Well, one thing you will find out really fast in life is that one or the other of the partners does most of the talking. Seriously. You will learn that. And you just got to figure out how then you manage that process. To get her talking originally, I just had to sit there and say, well, we're going to be quiet until you start talking. And I had no problem with just sitting there. And that led her to then start responding. And she knew, and again, you got to understand, it's a relationship. If you're going to build a relationship, you have to be able to not only talk, but then respond properly with etiquette and niceness and sweetness.
So in the beginning, what would you say? How do you respond when you don't agree with something that's being said, but you're wanting this person to share their feelings?
Well, you got to be careful of how you say, I don't believe that. Now, my style and my personality says, I just kind of shake my head and say, that's not good. That's my style. And then when I'm upset, I'd say, come on. You know that ain't right. Right? So I'm kind of like two-sided. Sometimes I just sit there and, oh, Lord. And then other times, come on. And I think, though, that there's somewhere in between that, that you got to be able to just back it down, hear what they have to say, because they're coming from a perspective that will, and if you just encourage that, they will start talking.
And I wrote in my notes in response to a couple of those questions you gave us, knowing you have each other's back, knowing that he has my back, knowing that he wants my best, knowing that he's trying to help me, and he knows I'm trying to pour into him as well. So it makes it easier to talk and to communicate and to listen, because you know this person has your best interest at heart. You have to know that. This is not a competition. This is a cooperation together.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Questions?
Back there in the corner.
I have a question about respect, and maybe I'll give an example. And my question is maybe just to ask, what if one community's ideals of respect or what amounts to a good woman is not the same as another community's? Mm-hmm. And maybe just to give you an example, like some communities, like as a woman, you're supposed to kneel down, mm-hmm. you know, when you're serving your husband, maybe tea or things like that. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to be really docile and kneel down and do all that. Mm-hmm. And in some other communities, women are not taught the same thing. Mm-hmm. But I think for many gentlemen, I think the ideal would be this woman who kneels down and and all that. So as a woman, do you conform to what are those community standards, or how do you tackle it, particularly if you don't come from the same cultural heritage where you have to do some of those things?
I think it's very important to understand those cultures and what those expectations are. Huh? Christian?
Not one of those who believes it.
What did he say?
Thank you for that question, though, Julia and Christian, because it is important that we understand each other's cultures. But I can't stress to you, we say it all the time, stress to you reading God's word. And for men as well, I want you to read God's word. Nowhere in God's word does it say that this woman is less valuable to you than you. In fact, God made her just right after he made him, right? It wasn't like thousands of years later that he made him, Adam and Eve, for her to be a helpmate. And there's blessing in that. Maybe an example I could give is that, and he's been very gracious about this, but in the Italian family, mama cooks, and mama's really good at cooking, and mama loves to be in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. Ain't that mama? And so this was actually one of those things where you're merging cultures, and you're merging not just cultures but people. I know that there are others that don't cook as much as someone else does, or others who. But one thing I will tell you is that I can only speak from experience. I do want to serve my husband because the Bible compels me to do that. And it tells him to love me like Christ loved the church, which meant he gave his life, which means he gave all of his ideals and opinions. And Jesus said, I wish I didn't have to do this. Could you let this cup pass from me? But then Jesus said, okay, Lord, not my will, but your will. Sometimes you have to have that in marriage. One time, though, when we were married, and, he's very organized now, but clothes were all over. Clothes were all over the bedroom and the bathroom and, you know, and I was feeling upset about serving.
My mother used to pick them all up.
Because he's firstborn. And his mama did all these things. And I made a sign that said, your mama don't live here. And I put it on the mirror. But I want to tell you what else I said. I asked Jesus, what am I supposed to do about all this? You know what Jesus said to me? Be really glad those socks are laying by your bed today, not somebody else's. And from that moment forward, honestly, I pick up when I need to. I do dishes when I need to. I clean. I love to have a nice, orderly home. But I serve because I'm thankful that we're together in this partnership.
But I pick up my own clothes.
Yes, you do. Most days.
Wonderful, wonderful.
Good question, though. Great question.
Great question. You've got 40 years of marriage, and there's a lot of young people in here, or people who are looking to get married. This is your opportunity. So we want to see if there's any question. One more question. Brother Ernest. Okay. Oh, we got Cherry. Let's go with Cherry first, and then we'll come to you, Brother Ernest.
Hi. Is it on? Okay. It's not on? So my question is, how should a husband and wife react to a family decision that turned out to be wrong? Like, for example, you talked about your daughter getting hurt at school, and you both decided not to take her out. God forbid, what if it had happened again? Would you have been like, oh, Rick, this is your fault?
The Bible says two become one. Hmm. And that process is a spiritual process as you becoming husband and wife, but you become one. So when one makes a decision, it's not her decision or my decision. If you'll get through that process early in your marriage, you'll solve your a lot of problems. Because if you always point the finger at the spouse that made the decision and say that's your decision, it's going to bring separation in your lives. So say, we decided, we agreed. Now, she had a different opinion to start, if you want to use the daughter subject. She had a different opinion. She wanted to remove the daughter. I wanted to keep the daughter in the school. We then agreed. She said, okay, I'm gonna go with that agreement, so that when we sat before that principal and we had to deal with the authorities, it was a mutual agreement. She didn't sit on the other side of the desk and say, well, I don't want it to be this
way. That's very true. We came to that
meeting. Because we came to that decision. When you come to a decision in your marriage, this is a together decision. You speak as one. You have become one. You speak as one.
And also think about your relationship with your soul mate, Jesus. There's nothing that we can do that separates us from the love of God. And so there's nothing too difficult for God and me to handle. So even if some decisions don't go exactly the way we thought they would, or they don't turn out exactly the way they thought we would, that's why it's so important when you're both on the same page with Jesus, you can encourage one another even though you feel like, I'm not sure, but there's just nothing. God can help us in anything, except we did want to say, in the physical touch, it should be loving and gentle and respectful. There is no place for abuse. And many of you know our older daughter has a story of a very painful past situation. And, there's just no place for that unhealthy physical abuse or emotional abuse for that matter. But when you love each other and you mutually respect each other, God will give you wisdom.
Wonderful. What I'm hearing is a lot of need for communication and even compromising, as you said earlier, to manage conflict in the marriage or disagreement. We're going to take two more. Brother Ernest, I think you had one, and then, yep. Oh, okay, one over there, and Brother Ernest will come back. Go ahead.
I'm not married. Okay. That's the first thing. But there's this thing that, we hear often, and it's not talked about, which is the aspect of jealousy. Mm-hmm. How do you manage jealousy in a relationship? Most especially when I realized that when a man lost his job, he tends to get cold. Mm-hmm. And he's, I don't know if I'll call it jealous of the wife who earns more. Mm-hmm. And he tends to have his own space. How do you get them to come out from that situation or come out from that jealousy? Because it's not talked about. And most men suffer this this thing of being not able to provide or not able to stand to their responsibilities. How do you get them to talk and
jealousy?
I think the first thing is I am who I am with Christ. I am somebody in Christ Jesus. My value of who I am, my identity of who I am, comes from Christ. And as a man, I have to be confident. With the job or without the job, I'm still valuable and important to Christ. Christ is my provider, not that job. And if I have that confidence, so most of the time it's a spiritual battle first. The jealousy side of it is an afterthought. It's an after process of this something that happened, particularly if we want to deal with the wage subject. And in our society today, there are a number of women that make more money than the man does. That does happen. But the man has got to see that as a good thing, not as a bad thing. But the woman has to see it as men are brought up as we have been taught. We have been cultured. I don't care what culture. You are the provider. You got to figure this thing out. And in today's society, worldwide, women have been given a higher position in jobs and
it's happening more and more.
It's happening more and more, and their wage is higher, and which is a good thing. For economics, it's a good thing for a lot of reasons. But I think the jealousy component in marriage has got to be that jealousy is not a God thing. It's a devil thing. You want to be straight up. Jealousy does not come from God.
And mutual respect is really important. So I also think you have to declare something over your family, over your husband or your wife. So if you begin to declare you're just being jealous and you just don't want, then I can go back to the before the marriage. Maybe you didn't understand. He knew that I came from a line, even though I was quiet. He knew that my grandmother was a woman preacher. My mother was a high-level executive with the government. He knew that I came from a strong line of women. So you got to go back to, that's why so important with the before, but if you haven't had the before and you're in a marriage now, it's about what you declare. So I can say, oh, you're jealous, or I can say, I'm so thankful that you support the work that I do, and I want you to know I'm going to support you during this process of a pause. And you declare things. You don't, it's kind of like, don't say what is always. Say what you want to have happen. You're declaring, you're making that declaration over your husband, over yourself, over your marriage, that I am valued, you are valued, we are respected. Those things are, so we do have to be careful what words come out of our mouth.
That's fantastic, that value and love and respect. If I may add just one thought of mine as well before we come to Meshach. It's a vicious circle and an enhancing circle of love and respect.
Yes.
You love, the more respect you give. So the more a wife, husband loves his wife, the more she respects him. The more she respects him, the more he loves her. Mm-hmm. And it's an enhancing circle. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, it's also a vicious circle, mm-hmm. because the less a man loves his wife, the less she respects him. Mm-hmm. And the less she respects him, the less he loves her. And so we have to go on that enhancing circle, continuous love and respect.
Yes, and I know we do need to stay on time too, yes. So we also want to help you do that. But we are here for you. And so in the future, if there are things that you want to talk about, I love praying with people, young people who are, or old people who are looking to meet with someone and to marry someone. So we're here for you as well. So we thank you for that.
We're going to take one more, and we'll just have, we've got 2 minutes, and then we'll go to the next session.
I'll just make a fast comment on her question about the loss of job and jealousy. In my experience with family, with brothers and sisters, I've come to realize that more often than not, it is not jealousy, but it's the matter and way in which we deal with loss. Mm-hmm. A loss of a job is a very serious thing.
Right.
Be it with a husband or with the wife. Mm-hmm. Because even if it's with the wife, she had her own way of doing her own things, and she had an income. Mm-hmm. And I've seen with my own siblings, with my own relatives, that when we don't deal with this as a loss,
yes.
as someone who's lost something that is precious to them, mm-hmm. then we can create more problems.
Good.
So for me, jobs, it's a loss. Mm-hmm. And it's whatever the spouse, the husband or the wife, mm-hmm. the other partner has to take it very seriously and know that they need to support them, they need to be with them. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, things can really deteriorate because that is someone who has lost something precious.
Amen. Thank you for that, Meshach. That's awesome.
Wonderful.
Awesome.
I'll tell you what, we're moving into a family panel right now. And the family panel that we're going to move into is also going to discuss this subject.
Yes.
And we'll also come back to the audience during the family panel. So hold that thought. Mm-hmm. We'll still come back
yes.
to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So thank you to Pastor Rick and Pastor Jennifer.
We're so happy that you listened to how your life can have influence. And we want you to reach back to us, email us, follow us on social media. You'll see the information there on your screen. And we want to pray for you today.
Thank you as you have listened to these people tell you about the influence that can happen in your life. We believe this for you. I guess that's why you've been listening. So I want to pray a prayer that God will help you over the next number of weeks and months as you become the influencer that God has intended for your life. So would you pray with me? Lord, I thank you for these friends that have listened to this amazing conference. God, you specifically pinpointed an area in each of our lives, God, that we needed a little work on. And God, we were able to hear from some incredible speakers to help us in some of these areas in our lives. So Lord, I pray as we place this at the altar today, we say, God, help us, because we really do need your help to be the influencer and to be able to stop the outside influences from affecting us in our decisions, in our families, in our workplace, and in our school. So today, God, I pray blessings upon each one of these listeners, and that, God, you will take care of them and take care of their needs. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Amen.
Bless you.
And we're excited to hear the testimonies.